Welcome, everyone. This is Jim Clodfelter with the Light Brigade. I'd like to welcome you to the sixth in a series of educational webinars that we're doing with Lightwave Online. I'd like to thank Stephen Hardy and his team for allowing us to do this each month. What you're going to see today is a webinar on fiber-optic passive devices. This is based on one of our fiber-optic DVDs that is available for purchase. We'll talk about it at the end of the presentation. And you can also see this first chapter of that DVD on YouTube. Our presenter today is Larry Johnson. We're very honored to have Larry with us, director and founder of the Light Brigade. I got a couple of housekeeping questions I want to go over with you. This presentation will be available online 24 hours after it is completed at lightwaveonline.com. And you can go and access our previous webinars at that site as well. We encourage you to ask questions. In the lower left corner, you'll have a space to ask questions. Technical questions will be handled immediately by our support staff. We're going to wait till the end of the webinar before we go to specific questions about the content. We want to keep a steady flow as we're making the presentation. If we don't happen to get to your question, we do make an effort to answer all of them via email after the webinar is completed. At this point, I'd like to turn this over to Larry for the presentation.
Hi, everyone. Nice of everyone to join us. A couple notes on the Light Brigade on screen. I don't think I have to cover these. I think they're pretty self-explanatory. So let's go on and move on to the main focus on passive devices. Ever since fiber was developed, invented, we needed to have the ability to monitor light, tap light, switch light, direct light. And these basic functions were made for mostly test and measurements at the time. But it evolved more to now to where designers can use this technology to basically perform functions that are great for system applications. We'll talk more about these in the different components. But one of the basic descriptions of a passive device is they do not require electrical to optical or optical to electrical conversion. This is unlike an active device such as a laser diode or a photodiode. So the types of splitters that are used, there's no electrical signal. They're strictly optical, and they split light in different configurations we'll talk about. So one of the neat things about light is the fact that we have the ability to split it. We can tap it, we can direct it, we can multiplex it, we can filter it, and we can switch it. And that's so. Moving on, let's take a look at it from a different perspective. Well, who uses these components? Well, we can look at it from a component manufacturer first, because components to system and then it goes to end user. But the component manufacturers, some of the typical products that use passive devices are the erbium doped fiber amplifier, which uses isolators, WDMs, attenuators internally. In fiber to the home type applications, OLTs and ONTs, we have filters, WDMs included, attenuators very easily. And we also have newer type products and technologies such as PICs or photonic integrated circuits. And in this case, where we're actually performing multiple functions such as arrayed waveguide functions or components integrated with lasers and modulators, MUX and DMUX functions as well. And what we're trying to do, especially with PIC technologies, is get smaller sizes, lower power consumption, and more optical integration taking place. System manufacturers take these components, though, and build them into system. And so, for example, dense wavelength division multiplexing systems can incorporate EDFAs, but they also, from the transmitter and receiver locations, have to be able to multiplex and demultiplex different wavelengths together as well. If we expand that, we can also take that same technology and integrate it into a reconfigurable optical add-drop multiplexer, or ROADM, and that where it could be a single fiber, it could be specific wavelengths are used, and it takes us from, say, ring architectures to mesh architectures or more extensive. And test equipment manufacturers use passive optical components. OTDRs is a very basic example where we have optical splitters, we have directional couplers, we have WDMs, optical switches in some cases, depending on the equipment manufacturer. But all these can be integrated into very common pieces of test equipment that have been used for decades in the outside plant. And then more recently, in the last decade, the end users and the service providers, where we're taking fiber to the home, and in this case, the people are actually seeing optical splitters for the first time, maybe not the consumer, but the service providers in particular, where we're putting passive optical splitters into pedestals and fiber distribution hubs in the outside plant. The types of optical devices, then, are these that are optical splitters, where we can split a percentage of light, whether it's equal or tapped types, wavelength division multiplexers and demultiplexers, such as dense and coarse wavelength division multiplexing uses, optical switches, such as used in ROADMs on the high end and that, but also some very basic 1x N switches. Optical filters as well, and not only fixed optical filters, but tunable filters that may be required for systems or in test equipment sides. Optical attenuators, people look at as just a basic device, but it's a passive optical device, and they use filters and polarizers and that, and there's also fixed and variable versions of those. Wavelength lockers is a passive device that doesn't get a lot of attention, but as we start spacing DWDM systems tighter, such as the 50 gigahertz spacings, they allow us to monitor the transmission and providing error correction due to laser drifting, whether it's due to aging or temperature variations. And then we also have isolators that work like optical valves where they allow light to transmit in one direction and they minimize or minimize any light returning back toward the source, or minimize or just stop light as a one-directional optical valve. Okay. Early optical devices were basically bulk optics, and you know, bulk optics tend to be lenses, discrete components. They allowed us in the very early days, and this, we're talking late 1970s, early 1980s, to multiplex the 850 and 1300 nanometer windows over multi-mode fibers and theoretically doubling the capacity of a network. And of course, at this time, this predates single-mode fiber technology. And in this case, it was using optical lenses, putting different coatings on them. They could be prisms, different filters, et cetera. And the example shown is basically a wavelength division multiplexer using two different lenses, one with the reflective coatings and the other with a filter allowing specific wavelengths to pass through. And, that, and then other to demultiplex that, you just reverse those components as well. So let's start with fiber optic splitters. And we're going to start with the oldest of these types is the fused biconical taper, more commonly just called an FBT. And the photograph you see is actually a manufacturing machine. It's like a fusion splicer, except a lot more exotic. And it fuses multiple fibers together. And that, and the graphic shows that as we put two fibers together, of course, without the coatings here, and we fuse or heat those together, then we can join the fibers together. But there's more to it. There's axial tension being occurred so that if we want a 1x2 splitter as an end result, we want equal power. That means that we're going to have to transmit power from, the left side to the right side, and then we have multiple power meters that are controlling monitoring the amount of power received and then controlling back to the source or to the element to basically manufacture the component. So if we want a 50-50 splitter, pretty logical, pretty easier to do. And then all of a sudden we want a 10-90 splitter, you have to change the configuration, more tension, more maybe an adjustment on the temperature cycle, or et cetera. Now, this looks very easy with a 1x2 configuration. Now, you're seeing a 2x2 configuration. One end is cut off and that, and then the end is degraded to the point where it doesn't cause reflections. We want to always minimize reflections on these components. So you actually want to be also, during this process, you want to be monitoring the when the part's cut for the reflection that from that port. To go to larger numbers, it says used in split counts less than 1 by 16. But you can cascade FBT splitters quite easily, too. So if I took a 1 by 2 and then put two 1 by 16s on, in essence, I end up with a 1 by 32. And that's so much larger counts. Or if you wanted a star splitter, you could go into much higher counts, maybe a 16 by 16 fiber configuration. So quite a few variations and options available for manufacturing this type of splitter. Okay. The other type of splitter that we see out in the industry and use more in larger counts, such as FTTx, where we see a lot of 1 by 32 splitters used at fiber distribution hubs, is the planar splitter. These are more compact. They're more, as you notice, a rectangular type box. Most of the time, you won't see those at a component level or a subassembly. They'll be put in something like, in this case, your CNA six-pack configuration, or it could be 1 by 8 or 1 by 16 or 1 by 32. Depending on space. And they're more modular, and they can easily be integrated into outside plant cable management products or those used in the head ends and central offices very easily. In this case, they're much higher density, much larger counts. They can also be integrated in with an FBT. So maybe you put a FBT 1x2 configured to a series of 1x32, such as the GPON system uses in FTTx installation, to get a 1x32 configuration. So going in back to the splitter packages, here's shown a 1x8 splitter into a modular cassette. The split ratio is specified at the ports, in this case in the input side, in this case using an SC-UPC interface. They can be put in splice trays. They could be put in packages for patch panels, splice closures, fiber distribution hubs, fiber access terminals, also known as pedestals. You can also put them, the FBT types, for example, can be put in the same physical size as a fusion splice, the heat shrink protector, so they'll fit into slots. And one of the configurations we'll show is a tap splitter, and I'll talk a little bit about how this can be used in rural installations as well. Okay, so the ITU-T space G.671 standard specifies passive devices. This is the one standard that if you're involved with passive devices, you should get a copy of it and have it, and it'll give you different values, and some of these are charted below, which I'll talk about. Some of the terms that are used in the industry, for example, in fiber to the user, fiber to the home, fiber to the building. Wavelength independent couplers are specified. These are known as WIC devices. And what WIC devices are is they have the same performance bidirectionally or at different wavelengths. And as we'll see, that the 1310 and 1550 are used at 1490 as well, nanometer wavelengths. But the attenuation has to be the same regardless of the wavelength or the direction passing through the splitters. Now, if we go into the G.671 standard, you'll see that that there's the theoretical value, but there's also the component value. And that what the component value means is this is the average of the minimum and maximum values that are written into the standard, which we'll also give you in a forward slide. And that so if you're designing a system, you want to use the component value, not the theoretical value, because as these are manufactured, there are tolerances that have to be considered. There may be splices that are included into it, and in some cases, connectors on connector ports. There's also the case of 2xn values as well, and in this case, the losses are slightly higher with the 2xn configuration. 2xn splitters tend to be used in where you have a protection route, so you have two different routes and that, but you're still using optical splitters. Tap couplers or tap splitters, and by the way, since I mentioned the word coupler and splitter in the same sentence, let me explain that. They're the same devices. And it's interesting, we'd rather use the term optical splitter than an optical coupler, because there's a lot of confusion in the industry that that a connection is a coupler in that, and that's not the case. Just because it couples two connectors together, two plugs together, it's not an optical coupler. And yet, in the G.671 standard, it specifies WIC, wavelength independent couplers, and uses the coupler term again. So we wish we could go back on terminology at times and clarify some of these points so we don't get confusion, but splitters and couplers are the same device. Tap splitters are very unique in the fact that by using the fused biconical taper technique, we can alter the tap percentage. In this case, I only showed up from a 1090 to an equal split 50-50, and the attenuation on one port will be different on the others. And if we, excuse me, and so where would we use this type product at? So, for example, we have test equipment, and sometimes we have to tap a percentage of light to monitor a function. An example is a pond power meter where you need to measure the upstream power level from an optical network terminal, but the safety feature built into the ONT shuts down the laser if it's disconnected. So the pond power meters have a tap splitter inside, so they can tap off a minor amount of light, maybe in this case a 1 by 99 percentage versus a 10 by 90. And then the attenuation for that 1% is zeroed out when it displays on the screen, so it's so that you're actually seeing the actual power measurement in that port use. OTDRs also use tap splitters, wavelength meters, optical spectrum analyzers, or other types of instruments that may use these. But for if you want to use these in a design, especially FTTx and rural configurations where you have a fiber route running down a rural road, and you don't want to put a 1x2 splitter and absorb a 3 dB loss on each one of these splitters, what you could do is put, say, a 1090 splitter in at the first fiber drop where you're doing a mid-entry into a cable, tapping 10% of the light off for that drop, 90% passing through to the next location. Now, what this means is you're going to have to engineer a loss budget for each span, in other words, from the optical line terminal to the optical network terminal. And that, so you have a minimal attenuation passing through, 0.6 dB for the 90% throughput, 11.3 dB for the 10% tap. So you still have to make sure you're within the dynamic range of your transmitter and receiver power loss budget for these. But in this case, it would be technically a bus topology, but in the FTTx vernacular, it would be a distributed bus, because the terminology is centralized distributed home run on pond systems. So changing gears from splitters to dense wavelength division multiplexing, which is technically the highest end systems being implemented worldwide, even though there's newer generations of products and technologies in the labs and such. DWDM is really the foundation of a lot of the fiber passive devices that we use today. When the attenuation requirements of oceanic links in the 1990s required the use of the 1550 nanometer wavelengths, we ended up with dispersion shifted fiber. The problem with dispersion shifted fiber is when you tried to optically multiplex signals together, you ended up with four wave mixing, and we started having harmonics basically in the signal. So a new fiber came out, which was non-zero dispersion shifted single mode fiber optimized for the 1550 nanometer wavelength. Then at the same time, you had some different inventions and technologies around the world taking place. Sir David Payne out of Southampton Labs and his work with erbium fiber, and Emmanuel Desavir with Alcatel in France with the basically building a system, but using an EDFA, which could optically amplify all the wavelengths in the C-band simultaneously, really pushed technology to where we could now multiplex wavelengths with much greater density than before, and this meant that our tolerances had to be tighter than that. So we ended up, we started with 200 gigahertz spacing, which is 1.6 nanometers, then 100 gigahertz at 0.8 nanometers, then 50 gigahertz at 0.4 nanometer spacings. Well, that meant that the filters and the WDMs and the MUXs had to be much tighter tolerances than ever before. And what that means is you have to have new types of test equipment that can measure at a tighter level to be able to manufacture a product at a with a tighter tolerance and that. So therefore, we had the tolerance issue, which meant new test equipment. It also created new products. But there was also another requirement because, again, remember the first systems here were oceanic, long spans, continent to continent, and that meant that tremendous role of reliability. They had to work. They had to be perfected for reliability. And in the end of all this, that during about the early 2000s, when we started seeing fiber to the home evolving, we could use these products but with looser specifications to get much lower cost reduction, and this applies to both coarse wavelength division multiplexing with 20 nanometer channels instead of the 0.4 to 1.6 nanometer spacings in DWDM systems. And FTTx is basically uses wide WDM with greater than 50 nanometer spacings between all channels today. So to do this, we have to multiplex light. And that, and the first bullet's talking about laser transponders, and they're matching the G.692 and the G.694 grids. Again, now you're getting two ITU standards. The G.692 standard is for DWDM, and the G.694 standard is for CWDM. These specifications were written that allowed manufacturers to know exactly what the expectations were, the tolerance for it as well. The laser transponders today are primarily packaged in SFP and XFP formats, and that so it's much lower cost. You can have a motherboard or rack mount unit, and then you can buy different SFPs or XFPs based on the specifications you're using, which reduces cost. While you can use splitters for multiplexing different wavelengths together, they do add additional attenuation, so they're not used as much today as they were in the early days. And in fiber to the X-type networks, these components for multiplexing and demultiplexing light are used in components such as called as diplexers, triplexers, and the newer quadplexers. Okay, so demultiplexing light's always more complex than multiplexing. We're using optical filters and gratings, and that, these are two different types of passive devices as well. The wavelengths and the bands are assigned by ITU standards, and these are different topics here. The wavelengths are assigned by the DWDM and CWDM standards, the G.692 and G.694, where the bands that are used are terminology versus windows, which can be the especially the fiber to the home standards, G.983, G.984, G.987 standards, and that specify these. And again, the DWDM specifications at much tighter spacing as we improved tolerances to move from 200 gigahertz spacings or channels down to 50 gigahertz channels. And then, of course, with CWDM, we can use much wider channels. And when we say lower cost components, an example would be we can use an uncooled laser versus a cooled laser that DWDM would require. And again, if we don't have to cool a laser, we have we're going to have more drift, but we have much wider channels, so we can compensate for that within the channel width. And again, the diplexers, triplexers, and quadplexers in fiber to the home systems incorporate filters to perform the MUX and DMUX functions. So a Bragg grating is a passive device. It's manufactured by exposing a length of photosensitive fiber to a excimer-based laser in the ultraviolet spectrum. But they're used to allow us to filter specific wavelengths, and that, and what this is really useful for, in this case where we can pass, say, 16 wavelengths down a fiber, but we can reflect one wavelength back, and that for doing an optical add-drop multiplexing very easily. In this case, we're also showing an optical circulator that can be added in, and we'll explain that a little further on. But fiber Bragg gratings, besides being used to filter wavelengths for optical add-drop multiplexing, can also be used for gain flattening of EDFA laser optical amplifiers, which as they amplify through the C-band, not all the wavelengths are amplified at the same level. So Bragg gratings can be used to flatten out the gain. Another is dispersion compensators. And while there are dispersion compensating fibers, the difference in systems is one, there's an attenuation penalty on using DCF. The other is there's greater latency because of the length of the fiber. So the FBG technique is has benefits for users and therefore system manufacturers to implement. And so if you're going to be using a system that requires dispersion compensation, you may pay attention to the type of latency measurements and attenuation requirements and which is going to be best for you. Fiber Bragg gratings are also used in wavelength lockers. And what wavelength lockers are, they're another passive device, but because of the tight spacings of DWDM systems and the fact that lasers can drift due to aging or temperature variations, they lock the laser into a grid, and therefore we don't end up having other arbitrary issues assigned. But it is a passive device, and these type components, you're typically talking an attenuation level of 0.1 dB. So taking this another step further, the optical add-drop multiplexing is incorporating the fiber Bragg grating with an optical circulator. So the optical circulator uses Faraday rotators, beam displacers, and wave plates so that any signal coming into port 1 is directed to port 2, and any signal coming into port 2 from the opposite direction is exited through port 3. In this case, a fiber Bragg grating or a fiber Bragg core is terminated to the optical circulator, so it allows us to reflect back whatever channel is specified, and then that channel's dropped. When that channel's dropped, that also frees up that channel for new upstream. So you put another optical circulator past the fiber Bragg grating, put the input into port 3, which will then route it back to port 1 to port 2, and then back down the fiber. Okay, they're used primarily in long-haul systems, and that, but also in ROADM systems, reconfigurable optical add-drop multiplexing. If we go to fiber to the home as a different category, we have the components themselves would be the filters, lasers, and photodetectors. Once it becomes an optical subassembly, then it becomes a diplex or triplex or a quadplexer. One second, please. Every once in a while, you have to take a drink of water just because the throat goes. So anyway, the diplexer has two bidirectional functions, and that so typically for all the legacy PON systems, which is BPON, GPON, and EPON, it filters the downstream 1490 nanometer wavelength at the ONT while combining the upstream 1310 nanometer for transmission, which would then be filtered again at the OLT. And that, meanwhile, it's multiplexing upstream 1310 at the ONT, and it's also multiplexing the 1490 nanometer at the OLT. Now, for the triplexer, this is three functions instead of two. And in this case, we're multiplexing both 1490 and 1550 nanometers downstream, and then demultiplexing it at the ONT or at the residence or subscriber's location meanwhile, at the same time, multiplexing the upstream 1310 nanometers. I know it can be sometimes tough to remember all this. Fortunately, the G.983 standard, the original legacy BPON standard, established these wavelengths and the functions of the diplexer and triplexer, and they've been carried over into the G.984 GPON standard and the IEEE 802.3 AH EPON standard as well. So basically the same components optically. Okay, let's take it one step further. Let's go to the quadplexer. See, what's in the future, and when the 10G systems are going to overlay the legacy PON systems, that means that we're adding additional wavelengths for upstream and downstream transmission. And that, in this case, because the 1490 basic band is being used downstream for digital transmission, and the 1550 nanometer wavelength can still be used for RF transmission, and then using an external WDM being combined. So we have 1490 and 1550 for downstream, and then at the far end, we have to demultiplex those and then multiplex back upstream at 1310. That's your basic diplexer, triplexer combination. But now we have the 10G systems. The downstream wavelength is 1577 nanometers, and then upstream, the 1270 nanometer spectrum's being used. So what we have now is two additional wavelengths versus the two original, not counting the WDM at 1550, which is always external and used in RFOG and RF overlay, RF overlay systems. Also, just as a note, that when you hear these numbers, 1490, 1577, 1270, 1310, that's the mean average, the center wavelength of the spectrum that's assigned. So 1490 is actually 1480 to 1500 nanometers. 1577 is actually 1575 to 1580 nanometers. So most of the time when you're hearing these terms, you're getting the center spectrum. You need to see the standards to pick out the exact spectrum that's being used. For example, there's wavelength blockers used on coexistence, and that's talked about at the top when legacy PON and 10G systems that coexist. And just as a clarification on the 10G systems, this could be an IEEE 802.3AB standard, or it could be the ITU G.987 GPON system as well. Okay. So anyway, four functions, but they get more exotic, and that just means that we have to use more passive devices. The passive devices are going to have tighter tolerances, but even still, this is nothing close to what DWDM tolerances have to be. It's still maintaining a low cost. So other types of passive devices are optical switches. And optical switches have been around for decades as well. They are continuing to improve. We still have the basic functions that you need to be concerned with any type of product, and that is attenuation, reflectance, latency. One additional thing with an optical switch, though, while they are passive devices, they do require an electrical input. And the reason is you still have to move something. And that normally, it could be a 5-volt signal power level, very, very low. But they do require external power in that. But the optical function, as far as signal in, signal out, is all passive. Okay. And different types of switches are used. The optical, electrical, optical switch, and that, and these the network type switch. So this is pretty basic. You have a transmitter. You have a fiber span. You transmit to a distant location. Now you convert it back to an electrical through an electrical receiver, optical electrical receiver, and then you retransmit. Now you can switch from that in the electrical domain, and because it's in the electrical domain, that means we can provide all of the 3R functions. That's retime, reshape, reamplify. And they do tend to be more costlier. You do have to provide power, and there's a greater latency with these. if we go back to the real early switches, and these are still used, you know, in massive numbers and that, but take an OTDR where we want to switch a laser from 1310 to a 1550. It's very easy to put a 1x2 bypass switch in and just switch which port, and so it could be integrated in. Or if there's those here that remember the old fiber data distributed interface standard, the ANSI X3T9 standard with the self-healing architecture, it used 2x-in or 2x2 optical bypass switches and was probably the first fiber standard that actually incorporated self-healing architecture. It was eventually outdated just because it was a fixed 100 megabit system, but the technology to engineer a passive device into a system to provide a benefit for the users and to have a protection option was there. And so bypass switches are still very easy to deal with. And okay, moving on to the MEM switches, which is micro electrical mechanical. These elements are integrated into a small chip, large numbers, 512 by 512 with a goal of 1024 by 1024. Basically micro switching, microsecond switching technologies, several different techniques on manufacturing these, with the most common is mirrors mounted on post with electrical circuits moving the mirrors themselves. Another type of optical switch is the optical cross-connect switch, which reduces latency. It's a 100% optical switch and can go to much larger switch configurations. And these are specified, optical switches are specified by the Telcordia General Recommendation, or GR 1073 standard. Another type of switch is the matrix switch, which are used a lot in network testing, switch testing, or add-drop multiplexing as well. And in this case, we're showing five nodes configured through a network switch. Okay. And the granddaddy of them all is the integration of these components, where we can take DWDM technology and optical switch technology and come up with a reconfigurable optical add-drop multiplexer, or ROADM. And this is used by service providers to go from a ring topology to a mesh topology or more complex technologies. And you can provision specific wavelengths that are identified by the ITU grids as well. And then there's different types of filters and wavelength blockers and switches. These are all passive devices that are integrated into these. Taking a look back at saying, why is DWDM so important? If you look at the different categories of products used in a DIDS wavelength division multiplexing system, you can see the different types of passive devices identified in every element of the system. And so when this technology was really invented in the 1990s and it's consistently being improved on, you can see where the attention that's given to passive devices and how important they are to fiber technology. The great thing from a user perspective is the fact that the reliability, the performance, the test equipment that was required for these was developed early, and even though it was very costly, this is how we communicate worldwide. But now we can use this technology in a much lower cost scenario. So what we come to our conclusion is that passive optical components provide optical solutions, and that technical improvements over the years have improved the reliability while also producing low-cost solutions for new applications such as CWDM and fiber to the user. Okay, so now it's a time for questions and answers. I don't know, we have a few minutes here. We may be able to pick up on a few, but I also wanted just to highlight that there's much more detail in one of our DVDs, staff development DVDs, the fiber optic passive devices, has actually 9 chapters. The introduction chapter you can watch on YouTube. but it's 118 minutes for nine chapters, and the animation showing how these components work, the technical descriptions, the components that are used are easy, and we'll send out an email on this on each one. So let me pass the phone over to Jim again, and thank you for attending.
Yes, thanks for everyone's perseverance. That was kind of an interesting challenge. We were asked several times through the presentation, do we make these slides available for download? And no, we don't. They're proprietary information that we use in our training classes, but you will be able to download the complete presentation from LightWave online once we fix the audio. We will have a complete audio track going with all the slides in the on-demand version, though it might take a day or two to get those together. Stay tuned for our next webinar, which will be on August 28th, when we'll address FTTx issues. We appreciate your time, and thank you for your attendance, and see you next time.